So, why were we interested in Curos? Pre-Curos intervention, Curos intervention, and the impact of Curos is what I'm going to discuss. We knew that we had a higher rate of BSIs in our trust. We were aware that there was non-compliance on scalpel health. For all of the clinical people in this room, for a needle-free device, we have to scrub the hub for a minimum of 15 seconds and a drying time of 30 seconds. If I was to give all of you a needle-free device at this moment in time and a wipe and asked you to actually scrub it without a watch for the allocated time, I think all of you would be very hard-pressed to actually come in on the timings that are required. The company came in with the Curos, and we like the concept of it. It basically engineers out the human element, and with Bible we had a history of participation working. We had worked with them before. The only British evidence on Curos so far had been a home parental nutrition outpatients study. We wanted to know if using Curos would improve compliance with port cleaning, and would there be a possible positive or negative effect on Lyme-related bacteremia. So who did we involve in the process? Obviously the Infection Prevention and Control Team, the Infection Prevention and Control Group, Evidence-Based Practice Committee, Divisional Nurses, Matrons, Ward Managers and their staff, Procurement and Viral. The challenges that we faced, the EPIC 3 guidelines, as you'll be aware, recommend a mixture of chlorhexidine and 70% alcohol. We had to motivate some of our colleagues. Initially, it was not seen as part of the aseptic non-touch technique performer, and potentially it would be confusing for staff. Like any infection prevention professional in this room, we spent a lot of time embedding ANTT into our trust. So to start thinking about changing that was challenging in itself. And then again, there was the potential cost. Vigon supported us by providing the product free for the trial. We actually asked Vigon to go to Stephen Rowley and ask if he would consider recognising the Curos as part of the ANTT process, which they did. They updated our trust's ANTT vascular access posters to incorporate Curos for the duration of the trial and for the four wards that were involved. We did some benchmarking audits, staff training, and monthly audits for the duration of the trial. It was a cross-site study utilising four wards. All of the wards contained patients who had medium to high use of intravascular lines. We did a retrospective review of the ward's BSI data, so we did 6 months review of all blood culture data prior to the 6 months trial, and we also did 6 months follow-up review as well. So altogether, the whole trial lasted about 18 months. We got procurement to remove the CHG wipes from the wards that were going to be used, and we did monthly audits on the wards that were undergoing the trial. So, audit. Did a survey of 104 staff from a variety of different departments, and there's a list of all the departments that we looked at. And these are our results. So, sorry, the duration is of physical cleaning is a minimum of 15 seconds, and the duration of the disinfection drying time of wipes is a maximum of 30 seconds. And this is what we find. So there's, against national data, you can see that our trust was 54% non-compliant with the cleaning time. For drying time, altogether, we were actually worse than the national average. We were 75% non-compliant. So as I said earlier, we did four wards. We looked at an oncology ward, an acute care of the elderly ward, an adult intensive care, and a surgical ward. And it was used for 6 months. So every month that the trial was underway, the blood culture data was captured, thanks to obviously our microbiology colleagues, who actually put the source of the what the infections were as well. Users completed a questionnaire on usability, and as I said, we did a post-intervention of BSI rates as well. And then we raised a business case. So what I'm going to show you now is the clinical practice compliance rates, the infection rates, a little bit about finance, user experience, and patient experience. So prior to, we weren't, apart from the prevalence audit that we did on compliance with the SCAB the HAB, previously we had not actually been auditing. And again, those of you who are clinical, unless you're actually on the ward at the time somebody accesses a needle-free device, it's very difficult to audit that that compliance. But what we did find was that with the implementation of the Curos, if we had an 80% or above compliance, our BSI rates went down on those wards. We had 26 line associated BSIs prior in the 6 months prior to the study, which works out at approximately 286 block bed days. And if it's peripheral line infection, we're looking at approximately 161,000. And that takes us to just under 500,000 if it was central line associated infections. During the trial, our rates dropped. In the first month, we had three, and in the preceding 5 months, we had four bloodborne infections. So that gave us a total of a 69% reduction whilst Curis was in use in those four wards. And this is a chart. If you, as I said earlier, if you've got an 80, you found that you have an 80% compliance, you can get this to work. So this is the pre-intervention period, and this is when the Curis came into being. And if we actually had 80% or above, what we found is we actually had a corresponding reduction in our line-associated infections within the wards. We had a mean reduction of just, what was it about? Well, it was 4.3 to begin with, and it went down to 1.5. So quite a noticeable mean reduction. And this one here is the post-intervention. So once we took the Curos away, we started having line-associated bacteremias in the intervention wards again. If the trust had had to buy the Curis, there would have been a total spend of just under £7,000. And for the areas that were having the Curis, if they were to use it for a year, it would have come in just over £3,000. And if you think about it, that's the cost of one, caring for one patient with a line-associated infection. It released 41.2 days to enable better care for our patients. And it works out 164 hours of clinical time was freed up by not scrubbing the hub. potential savings for the trust would have been just about £350,000. And I said we would have actually freed up 242 beds. We asked the staff what they felt about the QOS. They actually loved it. They really didn't want the child to stop. There was 100% satisfaction. They found it easy to use. They fully engaged in the training that went on, and they felt it was much more effective than scrub the hat. We actually used it in 1,094 patients. A month of 90 patients. They loved it. They loved the visibility of it, and they actually felt empowered in their care because they knew that if somebody came to them and took off their little green hat, as they called it, or their little green glove, and didn't put it back on, they felt that they could actually challenge and say, where is my new one? So they felt very much as if it was a partnership. Consequences of contracting infection, I'll leave you with that one. And questions will be at the end. Okay, thank you very much.